Welcome to Faith Community Church. Here are some upcoming events. We have two more evenings in February to play pickleball. That is February 22nd and 29th from 5 to 7 p.m. over in the Family Center. Come and have fun and hang out with other fellow believers. Make sure to check out our website at faithforgreatbend.com and also our page and group on Facebook at Faith Community Church of Great Bend, Kansas.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Faith Community Church. If you want to stand with us, we're going to praise and worship the Lord and have an awesome time this morning. Before we get started, I'd like to just ask if you guys appreciate the band up here. Just give them a warm clap. And also, I want to say a special thank you to Glenna for playing the piano. If you appreciate her, which I do, give her a huge clap. So that's just been awesome the past 3 weeks and helped me out and everybody else so much. So thank you very much, Glenna, for that. Okay, we'll get started.
Lift up his name within the sanctuary. Lift up his name among the people who are gathered. help is on the way. Oh my God, you will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true. My God will come through. Trouble surrounds me, chaos abounding. My soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. My help is on the way.
He will not delay.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise your Father.
Soul, your word is a lamp unto sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Let's sing that again.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Oh, sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. All creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Jesus, your name is power, breath, and living water, such a marvelous mystery, yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Thank you.
Just feel free to sing your own worship hymn. In your own words, express your love. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Father, you are holy.
Would say these are days upon which I will move upon the hearts of men and women and boys and girls. Those who have not known me, those who have not even heard of me shall begin to hear, and there shall be a drawing upon their hearts and their spirits towards me. For I would tell you this day that as I move upon their hearts, there will be a hunger increase upon them and upon those around about them and upon this nation. There shall be a hunger for truth. And I would tell you, this will be a thing of my spirit. It will be by my spirit. And there shall be no glory to any other, but it shall be to the glory of my Father, saith the Lord. For I would tell you, there shall be an outpouring of my glory. There shall be an outpouring of my grace and my mercy. But I would tell you to begin to expect those things and to declare those things over your family and over your community, saith the Lord. For I would tell you, I am moving upon the hearts of men and women and boys and girls. And you shall see a turning. In the midst of chaos, there shall be a change. And you shall see it, you shall marvel at it, and you shall declare, great is our God. For I tell you this day, to rejoice and to thank me, saith the Lord, and to look forward and to expect and to see these things, saith the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. He is faithful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Oh, he's good. Amen. Praise God. I don't want you to go anywhere. I just want you to sit down just for a moment. And Sina, we have a presentation we need to do. Praise God. Worship team, you can just hang steady here for a second. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. This is our Bible quiz team and team leaders. Yeah.
like she said, this is our Bible quiz team. We've been competing since October. And October was a preseason meet, and then November, December, January, and yesterday we've had competition. And we're in the I division, which they study 10 and 20 point questions. There are 288 10 point questions that Faith and Jeremiah have studied. And they study both the questions and the answers because they're encouraged to interrupt the questions at the meets. they have an award for the 10 point quizzers. They get quizzed on 30 random questions from those 288 questions. And if they meet the goal, which they only have to answer 20 of those correctly, but both these, Faith and Jeremiah, went above and beyond that. And so they are presented with this Bible Master Award for the Bible Discoverer. And then also yesterday, they keep track of the points that they earn all season, and they do individual scores and then team scores. And Nathaniel took the third place individual score for the whole season. Which Nathaniel is our 20-point quizzers, and the 20-point questions are definitely harder. They have, in both 10s and 20s, they have quotation questions where they have to quote scripture, but they have other questions mixed in from all sorts of things in the Bible and doctrine and that kind of stuff. But Jeremiah took second place individual high score. And then some of you noticed this trophy on the way in. They took second place as a team for the whole season in our area, so. they compete against churches Wichita West. So there's Great Bend teams. There was teams from Chanute, El Dorado, Oswego. In March, they are going on to compete at what they call district finals, which is Kansas City area and the Wichita district. So keep them in your prayers. But we are very proud of them, first year quizzers. So.
Praise God. That is wonderful. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. So you may stand up and turn around and greet each other. Amen. Thank you, worship team.
Glenn Imran. Well, good morning, everyone. If you can take your seat, we'll get started here. We'd like to welcome everybody to Faith Community Church. And I want to say something about this Bible team. Sherry and I had the pleasure of having all three of those in nursery when we got started. And I'll be honest with you, I got to confess this. You know, we do a story every Sunday with them. And if I didn't quite read the story right, or I may have skipped a page, they knew it. And they'd say, that ain't right. So, but I appreciate them. But also, you got to give a hand to their parents because they're the ones that started them on them. So I just appreciate you guys working that hard. Give the parents a big round of applause. So. Also want to say thank you on behalf of our family for the prayers. Knee surgeries went pretty well. I'm getting better every day. I didn't get any better looking, sorry. They worked on my knee, not my face. But, you know, you run into a lot of people that says, I'll pray for you. This church prays. And I thank you for that. So, Father, we just thank you today, Lord, as we come before you with our tithes and offering, Father. And we thank you for this day and this time, Lord. And we ask that this money that we're receiving, Father God, will be given out, Father God, to bless all the people around us, Lord. And we thank you for all the needs that you have met, all the needs that you're going to meet, because you are the great provider, Father God. Our jobs don't provide it, you provide it. We thank you for this, and we thank you for Pastor Joe and Pastor Sandy, and for all they do for this church, Father God. And we thank you for this and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, welcome again, everyone. We're glad that you're here. And if you're a visitor, there's a little card in the back of the chairs there. You can fill that out, and if you want to get on our mailing list, we just send out notifications of meetings and stuff like that. You can fill that out and take that to our information center, and we've got a little free gift for you. So if you're a visitor and you'd like to fill that out, you can do that. Also, anyone, if you have a prayer request, you can write that on the back of those also, and hand those to me or drop those in the offering plate anytime, and so we'll pray for those. We'll have service tonight at 6:00, so welcome you to come to that, and our regular services on Wednesday night, which have been powerful, so you don't want to miss out on those either, so we encourage you to that. Praise the Lord. I've been reading the book of Proverbs in the New Living Translation. And just to get a little, you know, I love the living because it takes out some of the poetry and gets down to the bottom line. And I'd shared one of these Wednesday night, and, you know, it's just something else to read. It's a paraphrase. It's not, if you're doing a study Bible, it'd be a different one. But I want to look at Proverbs 12:1. This is just some funnies. We'll have to bring that up. I think it's humorous. He's working on it. Maybe. Proverbs 12:1. Or I'll read it. There we go. To learn, you must love discipline. It is stupid to hate correction. That's about as blunt as you can get, isn't it? Yeah, it's stupid to hate correction. I just find that funny when I'm reading the Bible. And then Proverbs 15:17. There's another one here. A bowl of vegetables with someone you love is better than steak with someone you hate. But we're going to add an addendum to that. Not that we're supposed to add to the scripture, but to eat a steak with someone you love is just awesome. Amen? And that's what we did last night. We had steak at the banquet. And it was awesome, amen. But That's just kind of out there. See, God even knew that steak was better than vegetables. Amen, Brother Joe? Yeah, he's going, ah. My husband is not a vegetable lover particularly, but so praise the Lord. Good thing he loves me. We can have steak together. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, the title of my message today is Imagine, and Brother Doug has been hitting imagination pretty hard in Sunday school in our spiritual growth class. But I believe the Lord laid a message on my heart along that line, and I want to talk to you about imagine. Praise God. Hallelujah. Imagine means to form a mental image of something not actually present to the senses. That you're actually not seeing it, you're imagining it. You know, I have a great imagination. I can imagine about anything. You know, I can imagine a tiger walking across right here. I can see him. How many can see him? You're going to have to work on your imagination. I have a great imagination. And I think I probably developed that some from being a kid without TV. I'm so old. How old are you, Pastor? I'm so old that when I was a kid, we didn't have TV. That's just, oh my, we didn't have cell phone. We did have a phone, but it was a community phone. Other people were on it too. Praise the Lord. I'm glad that's over. Praise the Lord. I didn't have anybody to play with. We lived out in the country. And so I would imagine. I had Blackie the horse. I had a real horse, but I had an imaginary horse that was much more trained and better tempered than my real horse. And I'd ride Blackie, and we would have adventures all over the farm, all over the into the grass and into the crops. And my imagination, I had a great imagination. But it wasn't real, but you know that I would live in that. So I have a great imagination. But in the Word of God, it tells us to not have vain imaginations and not to follow those. So, you know, in Genesis chapter 11 and verse 6, there's a story about the Tower of Babel. And the Lord said, "Behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do." They were of one language, but they were not godly. They weren't following the Lord. And imagination was so strong and so powerful and such a strong spiritual force that as that one people, whatever they could imagine, God saying they could do it. And we see that even today, even though there's different languages, man can accomplish a lot by imagination. It was imagination that got us to the moon. People begin to imagine what it would be like, how to get there, what it'd be like walking on the moon. And so those kinds of things are strong forces. But vain imaginations and ungodly imaginations can be the downfall of a generation and downfall of a family or a person. In Romans chapter 1, verse 21, it says, "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened." Vain imaginations. You know, one of the meanings of vain is conceited, to think about oneself. And that happens when you begin to have vain thoughts. You're so looking at you. And then also vain means to be ineffectual. That you're not effective. That your imaginations aren't serving you for godly things, but they become of no effect. And it tells us in 2 Corinthians 10:5 to cast down vain imaginations. It says, "Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." That when we have those thoughts come to us. And we all have those things attack our thought life, that we're to cast them down. I'm in this HIIT class, you know, your exercise class, and you're supposed to pick up. It's kind of like, I guess, being on a chain gang. You know, you go dig a hole, go fill in the hole, go dig a hole. Same thing at exercise class. They want us to pick up this ball, the heaviest ball that we think we can handle, and I've made it to 12 pounds. But you do that 60 times, you know, and you pick up the ball and you cast it down. And you pick up the ball and you cast it down and you pick up the ball. You know, after a while, that does something to you. You either fall over or you get stronger. One of the two, but you're casting down. And so we're to cast down, like, man, we're not having this. We're not having this thought. Amen. Amen. We're taking a hold of it. No. We cast it down because it's a vain imagination. It's not effective. It's not bringing good to us. And those vain imaginations that are contrary to the truth, to the Word of God, to who God is, to your identity in Christ, we have to cast those things down. Rebellion. Anybody ever feel a little rebellious? You have a rebellious thought? We cast it down. Stubbornness. I know nobody in here is stubborn. To grab that and to cast it down. Unbelief. That's contrary to the Word of God. We cast it down. But there's also godly imaginations. You know, in Genesis 1, God had an imagination. And he saw what he wanted to create. And then he said, let there be. Let there be light. And, you know, it didn't happen like, you know, there's God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit, and they're there, and they're all one. And God said, let there be light. And light appeared. And Jesus didn't turn to God, and the Holy Spirit didn't come over and go, I didn't see that coming. I didn't think it was going to be that way. You see, they already knew. They already had the imagination of what it would be. And when he spoke it out, it was. You know what? You know, wasn't, you know, maybe there's a few animals, you know, like the zebra. They might have said, oh, I think the paint gun got messed up. It went to painting stripes on and off instead of one solid color. No. God saw all that in his mind. And then he said, let it be. It was an imagination, and he wasn't surprised by what it looked like because he had already seen it. He already knew it. And so as a godly imagination, in Hebrews 12:2, it says that Jesus, who for the joy set before him, endured the cross. In Jesus, he said he was doing that because of the joy set before him. He already, in his mind, saw you. And the joy of the relationship that he was going to have with you. That's why he could endure the cross. That's why he was thinking about you and me on the cross. Abraham, you know, God promised Abraham that your descendants will be like the sand of the shore and the stars in the sky. And he gave him this picture to look at, to have an imagination that that's how many descendants I will have. And that's come to pass. That has come to pass. But it was a godly imagination. Godly imagination is hope. Last week when Scott was here, he said, you know, when you begin to see a glimmer of hope, if there's somewhere you're seeing hope, run to it. And I thought that was good. If there's some hope in your life, run towards that godly hope. And godly imagination is hope. Because before God, he saw in his imagination what the earth and all his creation would be. That was hope. And then he spoke it into being. God's a faith God. He believed what he said, and it happened. Amen? It says in Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Or you could say, now faith is the substance of God's godly imagination. Amen? It's the substance of that. Because it is something that you can't see with your own senses, but it's godly imagination, and hope is that. And then faith takes hold of it and brings it into reality. Just like when God created the world, He brought it into reality. Jesus sparks our imagination. The Bible sparks our imagination. It says in John 4:35, lift up your eyes and look to the fields, for they're already white with harvest. There's something about that as Christians. When we hear that, it sparks something down on the inside of us that the harvest fields are ready to be harvested. And He wasn't talking about natural grain. He was talking about the souls of men and women, that they're ready to be taken. They're ready to be harvested. And what He's meant, they're ready to come to hear the good news. They're ready to be saved. They're ready to find out that God loves them. And so when you hear that, it sparks something in your imagination that there's a harvest out there. Amen? Praise God. In Habakkuk 2:14, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters covers the sea. To get in a godly imagination. There's something that sparks my imagination when I begin to think about that. That the knowledge of His glory will be known all over the world as the water covers the sea. That begins to spark some imagination in me. How is that? How's that going to work? What's that going to look like? God, open my eyes that I might see what You're doing. In 2 Corinthians 4:18, for while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. You see, when we begin to look and have hope, we're looking into eternal things when it's godly imagination. And we begin to see those things that are eternal. That means that those things around about us are subject to change. Hallelujah. In Matthew 18:18, assuredly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by My Father in heaven. I tell you what, if that doesn't begin to spark some imagination, that the things that we ask for will be done. What we loose here will be loosed in heaven. What we bind here will be bound in heaven. Hallelujah. Begins to cause my mind to imagine there's some things we're not tapping into. Amen? And so our imagination, Jesus, He was sparking our imagination. In John 14:12, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in Me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to the Father. And whatever you ask in My name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in My name, I will do it. If you love Me, keep My commandments. The greater works. I tell you what, you begin to think about that, your imagination. He's sparking your imagination. Greater works. What could be greater than what Jesus did? What is He talking about? What is that? And then He goes in the very next verse, you know, how are we going to do this? It's by the Holy Spirit. It says in John 14:16, and I will pray the Father, and He will give you another helper, that He may abide with you forever. It is the Holy Spirit who empowers us to be able to walk in those greater works. Just like with the Tower of Babel, when they were going to build that tower, anything they imagined with one language, the church has been given one language, the language of the Holy Spirit. And with what we imagine, those godly imaginations, when we come together and we begin to believe what He said, as we speak one language, there's nothing impossible to the church. Amen? Amen. Amen. Praise God. To begin to imagine those greater works and to begin to speak the one language by the power of the Holy Spirit that He gives us those visions. Matthew 28, 19 sparks our imagination. It says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." There's something that sparks in the heart of people's imagination, the believers, as they begin to imagine, how can this be? How can we take the gospel to the whole world? It begins to spark imagination of how that can be done and how that can be accomplished. In Mark 16, 17, it says, "And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. And they will lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Sparking the imagination. God looking and seeing what the church can do. Hallelujah. It sparks the imagination. Right now in our country, there are candidates, politicians going all over the place. And what they're doing is they're trying to fire up their base. There are people who are following them. And what they're doing, they're trying to fire them up with their imagination that this is what it'll be like if I'm president. They're firing up the base. Let me tell you, the Holy Spirit is firing up the base, the church. And He's firing us up with the power of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. And we are the base. And praise God, our candidate has already won. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And now we can begin to see what it would be like and imagine what it'd be like when the church really walks in her authority and who she is. We begin to see those things, what Jesus said, "You'll do greater things." And we begin to see that and take hold of it. He wants to fire up the base. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let the Holy Spirit begin to put imaginations, godly imaginations, and fire you up with the fire of the Holy Spirit, that He would baptize us with fire. Praise God. Fire up the base. Praise God. Church, come alive. Stand up and be who you are. Imagine. That's what this sermon is about. Imagine. Imagine. Which is that hope. Imagine the church full of the power of God. Full of the power of God. Let's take it right here to this place. Not out there in the world where it's elusive. You know, we're going to believe for the whole world to be saved. That's kind of vague. Power of God right here. Imagine what that would be like. Imagine what it'd be like for a move of God in Great Bend, Kansas. Amen. Amen. Lucas, Ellenwood, Hoisington, Larned, St. John, wherever you're from. What would that look like? Is it possible? Can it be possible? Imagine what it would be like. You see, it's possible because it's happened before, where whole cities have been swept into the kingdom and under the power of the Holy Spirit. We begin to imagine what it would be like for the power of God to flow. What would it be like if everybody on your block knew Jesus? He said, "Well, not everybody's going to get saved. They're going to know, have the knowledge of the glory of the Lord." Did everybody know what it would be like to walk out your front door and wave to your neighbor, and they yell, "Praise the Lord"? Amen. What would it be like to have revival in your school? Yes. to begin to imagine what that would look like. Kids catching on fire for the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Imagine what it would be like to see a revival sweep through the place you work. People talking about God, hungry for the things of God. Imagine what that would be like. Praise God. You see, imagine, and when you begin to imagine, it's hope. And when you pray about it and ask the Lord, give me a godly imagination. Begin to let me see what you see. You said we'd lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Imagine yourself praying for someone and them getting healed. And then praying for another one and then getting healed. Imagine what it would be like. Put in your imagination somebody getting out of a wheelchair. Somebody you know getting out of a wheelchair. Begin to imagine thousands getting healed. Imagine what it'd be like for this church to be full. First Assembly to be full. Foundry Methodist to be full. Some of them we won't list. But people overrun. Heartland being full. The Baptist Church being full because people are hungry to know God. Things like that have happened before. That there wouldn't be enough room to contain. The enemy has tried to steal our imagination of what we could do. All things are possible with Jesus. All things are possible. We begin to look beyond our own walls and begin to imagine what would it look like to have a revival in this place, in this town. What would it look like? You know, I don't know exactly, but praise God. I know one thing, when the Spirit of the Lord begins to move, people are saved, lives are changed, people are delivered, families are reunited. Hallelujah. People are talking about Jesus. We had a little bit of that in the 70s and 80s with the charismatic renewal and the revival. You go out to eat, the only thing people want to do is talk about Jesus, what God was doing. Hallelujah. Begin to look at those things that are not seen and begin to look and say, God, give me vision and imagination. Lord God, what would it look like for me to begin to pray for my neighbor? And then the next neighbor. What would it look like? Begin to imagine yourself going up and practicing telling them about Jesus. Imagine yourself doing those things. Hallelujah. Imagine that wayward child who's not where they're supposed to be, repenting and coming back to the Lord. God has given me a vision for a particular person. And I'm beginning to picture what it's going to look like when that person stands up and the darkness is gone. Hallelujah. And I'm praying for that person. And I'm imagining what it'll be like and calling them home. Praise God. See, we were designed. God gave us an imagination where things are birthed in Him. And as we ask Him to give us those imaginations, this building, this place was built with an imagination. That's how we operate. And in the spirit realm, it has long-lasting, eternal results. Praise God. So the Lord, spark our imagination. Because in our imagination, we begin to believe and take hold of it again. Hallelujah. Can you imagine this church full and with everybody's hands up praising the Lord? Everybody singing unto the Lord. Everybody on fire for the Lord. Praise God. Can you see it? I can see it. Praise God.
cars coming in. Yeah. Not enough parking. Amen. You say, well, that's kind of silly. No, it's not. Because God has said His glory will cover the face of the earth. Praise God, the knowledge of that. We've had prophetic word after prophetic word about what God wants to do. And it's time, church, to believe it. To imagine it. To be part of it. Hallelujah. To take hold of it and call it into this realm. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Imagine the fields are ready for harvest. Praise God. Begin to get that picture. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Begin to imagine those things and then to begin to believe. God, I believe all things are possible. There's nothing too hard for you. I'm not talking about vain imaginations where you get puffed up, you know, and we've had those. We were the one who preached the sermon that got Congress saved. Anybody ever preached that? Maybe that's just reserved for preachers. I was the one who stood in Congress and gave the invitation and they all fell to their knees. No, that's being puffed up. Amen? Doesn't have to be me. But you know, can you imagine having once again someone preaching the Word of God in Congress because that's how it used to be? Amen. Could you imagine that again? Or is your God too small? Boy, Sandy. You see, when you begin to say, no, church, begin to take hold of those things that God has called us to do. To stand up. God has placed in your heart some imaginations of things that He's called you to do. And sometimes a lot of stuff just gets thrown on it. The devil wants to take it away. We're not all going to do the same thing. But to rekindle and let that fire once again come to that vision that God gave you. And to begin to imagine that again. And say, God, form it. If it's a little askew, get it right. And begin to believe what God has for you. The thing He's called you to. He's called the church to be a light. Can you imagine when we are that light that the darkness dispels? Do we believe that? Can we imagine that? Praise God. Is the word true? When we let our light shine, we take the basket off and we let that light shine, what's going to happen? Darkness is dispelled. Praise God. Hallelujah. This sermon was for me to begin to imagine again. Praise God. And to take hold and to contend for those things that belong to us. Like our children. Those who are gone astray. Begin to contend for those prodigals to come home. Begin to see that and to call it. Amen? Begin to believe that when we preach the gospel, that the gospel is sharper than a two-edged sword and it pierces into the hearts of people and lives are changed. To believe that and to see that. Praise God. And to imagine those things. And then to take hold of it by faith. Praise God. God, He said we'll do greater things. Can you imagine yourself doing that? And then walking that out. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There's teaching and there's preaching. Preaching is to inspire you to go to another level. To shake off, to cast down. And to begin to believe God for those things. Praise the Lord. Jesus said, He's coming back for a triumphal church. Amen. Can you imagine that? Right now, that's not going to happen. Well, Jesus could come back at any time. No, we're not triumphal yet. There's some other key things that needs to be in place. Unity. Woo! We got a ways to go. But unity in the Spirit. But I can tell you what, there's a move across our country that's happening. There are groups of people coming together, partnering together, and they're imagining that they can take this country for Jesus. You say, well, I just don't know if that's right. Well, you know what? I don't want to be sitting down over here when Jesus calls me home and going, you know, I just didn't know if I should preach the gospel. I just didn't think it'd work. Says he's looking for those who'll have faith. Amen? Praise God. Believe God. Thank you, Jesus. There are groups of people coming together from different doctrines. But they have one common thing. They want to see people saved and a move of God. That's unity. And they're believing that it's possible that we can touch our country for Jesus, that lives can be changed, that people can come to know. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine our schools just turned upside down because they had a Holy Ghost breakout in biology class? Praise God. Can you imagine such a thing? Praise the Lord. Begin to expand. It is possible, church. It is possible. Jesus is firing up his base. He's firing us up with the Holy Ghost. Praise God, the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. You get there. Praise God. You guys need to be from some of those other churches. I've seen them on TV when the preacher's preaching good. Have you ever seen them? They're sitting there, and the preacher says something good. Praise God. Hallelujah. Preach it, sister. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Said, you're being just... Hallelujah. Well, I got some amens. Yeah, got a little movement. Praise God. God just wants us to really just trust him. And listen to what he's saying. And expand our thinking. Expand. It is possible to take Barton County for Jesus. Can you believe that? Amen. Russell County for Jesus. Yes. Pawnee County for Jesus. Yes, Stafford for Jesus. Yes, amen? Amen? Begin to think, yes, it is possible. Begin to imagine and dream those visions that God wants to save a lot of people. Will there be resistance? Of course. When they went to the moon, they had a vision. They had a little bit of resistance. Amen? For one thing, gravity. That was a big issue. But when you believe, the power of believing in a godly imagination, whole places can be changed for the power of God. Remember Reinhard Bonnke, he's went home to be with the Lord. And I don't know if you follow him, great, great evangelist. And he kept saying, Africa, yeah, Africa for Jesus. People probably thought he was crazy. And the impact he had on that nation, one man who had an imagination, who could see himself going into that country and preaching Jesus Christ. I bet he saw himself up on the stage and envisioning people there getting saved. And as it started to grow, he began to envision more. And millions would come to one service. I've seen video of millions of people standing there and the power of God sweeping across those people. And it was like waves. It looked like an ocean where people were just touched by the power of God. Can you imagine that? Staunch old United States. Hallelujah. getting touched by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And begin to let that. That can happen. Praise God. So I don't know what the timing of everything. Again, hallelujah. I'd rather be somebody moving in faith, believing God, than going, well, I don't know if it's time yet. Praise the Lord. Pushing our imagination. Imagining yourself doing exactly what God has you to do. Being in the right place. Imagining yourself in that wonderful relationship with Jesus. Knowing Him. Knowing His touch in your life. Knowing what it's like to walk with Him. Simply giving our hearts to Him. Praise God. Imagining yourself being in and walking in the will of God. That's the place He's given us. To see ourselves. To see ourselves helping those that are in need. Seeing ourselves preaching. I've shared this story, but as a kid, I used to preach to the cows. I really didn't have any idea what I was doing, other than I liked to preach. I don't know what I preached. Who knows? But the cows would come, you know, out on the farm, because cows are curious. They're very curious. So if you're out there doing something, they come over and see what you're doing. And I would preach to them, imagining that I was preaching to people. Cows are an advantage, praise God. They all got saved. And when you would make those dramatic, you know, points, and if you really just kind of jumped with it, they'd all jump. You know, that's kind of how they are. Praise God. Imagining yourself. Amen. Imagining yourself sharing and giving the gospel. Amen? Praise the Lord. Expand. We're taking Barton County for Jesus. I don't know how all the logistics, but it's going to happen. Barton County for Jesus. Will everybody get saved? No, not everybody will get saved. We know that. But everybody is going to know about the knowledge of the glory. And they will be without excuse. Amen? Wherever town you're in, begin to declare over that. Or your county, begin to declare. Begin to see it. So many things, and begin to pray about it. Begin to pray those things and to speak those things out. You know, there's so many testimonies of great preachers and people who started revivals. They started in prayer. They started to have a vision for that place, for the place they were, and they begin to pray about it. And they begin to see it. And they begin to call upon God, and begin to declare it, and there was a move of God. It's not really, well, if or why, but why not? Why not? Why not trust God? Why not expand and begin to declare those things? See yourself going out to eat and the waitress coming by and saying, you know, God loves you today. You need anything prayer for? I'm a very reserved person. And I like to just keep in my little... I don't want to intrude upon other people. But to begin to look out, begin to see myself differently, that I'm one who cares for the lost. Begin to look out. Amen? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Expand. We can take Barton County, this whole central Kansas area, for Jesus. Amen. Well, what about the rest of the country? They've got believers there. We'll start here. Hallelujah. Praise God. If we all moved to Mexico, there wouldn't be anybody here to get Great Bend saved. Okay? Or wherever. China. Anybody want to go to China right now? Praise God. We start here. We change here. We change our world. Praise God. Hallelujah. Begin to ask the Lord, give me an imagination for what you want. You're not going to get the full picture. It'd scare us. If the Lord would have showed the full picture of what I would have been several years back, for one thing, it would have, nah, that won't ever happen. And many of you would have voted the same thing. No, Sandy's not going to be pastor. What are you talking about? About 30 years ago, how many would have thought that? Sherry believed in me. Praise God. No. But he'll begin to show you the path to walk in. Amen? Praise the Lord. Please stand with me. And we're going to pray. Hallelujah. First off, we're just going to make Jesus first in our life. Amen? And we're just going to pray together. Lord Jesus, I thank you. We just call upon you as our Lord and Savior. Lord, we turn our hearts over to you. We commit to you. Lord, we give our lives to you today. Lord, we thank you for salvation, and we receive that now. We receive that salvation. We open our heart to you. We receive you into our life. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you are real and that you have a good plan for our life. That, Lord God, that you gave us salvation. We were on the road to hell, and you have set us free, and we give our lives to you. We thank you for that. And, Lord Jesus, I pray that today, that this church make a change. We begin to look and imagine, how can we reach this community for you? Begin to have those imaginations. Plant those strategies and that thinking into us. Lord, your strategy, your way, your imagination that you have for this place. It is your will and your desire that everyone come to know you. And so, Lord, we ask that you would give us direction. You give us insight. You would give us imagination of how we can touch our communities. Lord God, we declare, Lord, that your glory will be known in every place. Lord, that people will come to know you. Lord God, that hearts will be changed, that there will be a hunger in their hearts to know God. Lord, we cannot do this by our own might and our own power, but it's only by your Spirit. And Lord, I believe that you are firing up and stirring up your base, your church, to the call to receive the harvest, to begin to see the harvest, to begin to see, Father, your revival, your move of God. Lord God, we look to you. We long for that. Lord God, we call upon you for our neighbors and our friends and those that we work for or and work with. Lord God, that there be a change, Lord. We call upon a move of the Holy Spirit to soften hearts, that they will be ready to hear the gospel. Lord God, we thank you this by your power and your Spirit. Lord, and you'll get all the glory. We worship you. Lord God, we thank you for giving us new vision. Lord God, that we have purpose. We have a thing and a purpose to complete while we're here. And we give you praise. We give you glory. We thank you, Lord, for changing and stirring in our hearts today. Lord God, that we would begin to see those things. And we declare them and we call them into the natural. Lord, open our eyes that we might see. And we look to you and we thank you for it and we give you the glory. Lord, I speak healing and health over every person in this place. That they would prosper, that you are our provider. Lord God, you are our protector. You are the one who heals us and delivers us. You're the one who provides for us. Lord God, you are our heavenly Father. We thank you for health and healing. We thank you that we have the mind of Christ, a mind, Lord God, that is amazing, Lord, that you've given to us to see things like you see. Lord God, we praise you. We thank you, Lord, and in everything you are our answer. And we praise you and we worship you. And Lord, we come with joy and excitement. Lord God, we praise you. We give you praise in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen, amen, amen. Praise God. Give him the praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We love you and we're so glad you were here this morning. God bless you, that your steps are ordered of the Lord, and you're dismissed.